This guy is the E.F. Hutton of AA now.
Yeah.
Oh, listen.
Rummy. And I have recovered. A lot of people I hear them always say they're recovering. When do we recover? Well, we recover when we go into this program. And we can stay recovered as long as we stay in the program. If we want to unrecover, why, we either neglect going into it or get out of it, quit going. Quit attending meetings and quit working by the plan that we have. You know, I hear an awful lot of things about this program, and I probably have had more opportunity to hear these things and see them than good many people have since I've been around here longer than anyone else. And I've had my last AA birthday was in February. I had 44 years in this fellowship. So this does not qualify me as Moses, but believe me, I have learned a few things. As dumb as I am, you have to learn something in that length of time if you stay active and stay around these people. And I hear an awful lot of things about this program, and I hear people say how hard they're trying to work this, and they're working this, and they're working that step, and they're working something else. And I hear them say sometimes, I don't know how it works, it just works. Well, shucks, if you read the big book, it tells you how it works in chapter 5. And I'm a fundamentalist in AA. I believe in the fundamentals of this program. I happened to come into this program before it was known as Alcoholics Anonymous and before this 12-step program was put together yet. We had a 6-step program in the old Oxford movement, and all the people who preceded me and a number of them that came afterwards came into that Oxford group. But we found that alcoholics are different than people, and we found that alcoholics have to have their own society. We owe our origin to the Oxford movement, and they were wonderful people, but they were all civilians. And I saw very early in my life in this fellowship friction developing between the earthlings and the rummies. And it got to the point where it got rather desperate at times. But due to a number of reasons, we had to break away and start our own fellowship, mostly because of the idea of religion. Nobody here is against religion, I hope, but this wasn't what I'm talking about. The Oxford movement was a Protestant religious fellowship, and Catholics did not belong to it for the simple reason their church did not permit them to. And in my struggling around to try to find some members, when I left the city hospital in Akron in February 1938, my sponsor, Dr. Bob, told me to go back up to Cleveland and spend the rest of my life fixing rummies as an avocation. And I start up there and tackling rummies every place I could find them. Now remember, we had no book, we had no group, we had no literature, we had no nothing. So I'd walk up to some drunk on a street, and I tell him, hey, Buster, you ought to quit drinking. You ought to be like me. Well, this is a great approach. And I did get some resistance. But after 7 months of that carrying on, I finally nailed a guy, and he is my first baby. And I got him in the hospital. And I was walking 4 feet off the ground. I finally had accomplished something. I think in those days, my main object was I didn't feel I'd ever be a member of this great fellowship until I had successfully sponsored someone. So I went out after that with a vengeance, and mostly the vengeance was taken out on me. But anyway, it finally happened, and I've come to realize why It took me 7 months to sew up my first baby. It says something in our program about carrying a message. Well, I simply didn't have a message. I had a lot of time, a lot of brass, a lot of eagerness, and a lot of ego, and what have you, but I had no message. I finally got one, apparently, because this fellow bought it. He was this poor guy, he was a captive audience, but he bought it anyway. And from that point on, they start coming in real fast. Had a dozen men going down to Akron from Cleveland, and as it happened, seven of them were Catholics, and five of them were other infidels. And they saw this performance going on in the Oxford movement, all this witnessing and getting guidance for other people and reading out of the King James Version of the Bible and all this. It really got wild sometimes. These Catholics looked at me and looked at each other and they told me they couldn't take this. So by this time we had written the AA book. That was written in the fall of 1938, and this is May of 39 I'm talking about now. So I went down to see my sponsor, tell him our problem. And he said, well, we're not keeping the Catholics out. I said, no, you're not keeping them out, but their church keeps them out. It's the same thing. They can't come in. He says, well, that's their tough luck. I says, no, it's not their tough luck. We don't need this kind of thing. All this fault are all in the Oxford group that they can't handle. We don't need. We got the 12 steps in this book now, and we have the four absolutes of honesty, unselfishness, purity, and love. Anyone can live by that. I don't care if he's a Catholic or if he's a Hindu or what he might be, or if he's nothing, he can do this. Well, you can't do it. I said, we got to do something. So that's when the first unity came in AA. We had the biggest damn riot you ever saw. Down in Akron, and I thought when I announced that we weren't coming down there anymore, we're starting our own group in Cleveland. And then I made the mistake of telling them the address where we're having the meeting. This is bad, because next Thursday night in Cleveland, that whole bunch descended upon us, and they tried to break up our meeting. And one guy was going to whip me, and this I must add was all done in pure Christian love. But that was a second indication of unity. But we stuck together, and that's how AA started. It starts in a riot, and it grows in riots. People talk about unity and all that crap. If we had unity in AA, you'd have one big group and about six people doing the work and the rest of them getting drunk. There are people come in this fellowship that have to move. They're leaders. They have to do something. They can't sit in that back row, and they can't sit on their hands. Alcoholics have peculiar tendencies and personalities, and they have to be doing something. Alcoholics are doers, they're not thinkers. Alcoholics don't think, they emote. No alcoholic's ever going to do anything until he feels a certain way. If he hurts badly enough, he'll do something. If he don't, all the king's horses are not going to pull him into it. So this is a way we have to prepare ourselves for membership here. You and I belong to the greatest fellowship in existence. I don't mind telling you that. I believe it, too. And I'll tell you why. Everybody can't be an alcoholic. I don't think that over 8 or 10% of the population can become an alcoholic. I don't care how hard they try. They just don't have it. And we are very fortunate people. And we can get along with each other one minute and be killing each other the next, but we always love one another in the last analysis. It's great. We are the craziest bunch of people in the world. But I'll tell you what, if you're not nuts, you don't belong here. And we are, and people wonder about these things, you know. That's why other people can't understand us. They just can't figure out. And we do things, I do things today. Somebody say, why did you do that? I said, how do I know? We don't think about things. You never see an alcoholic sitting down there contemplating his navel. You don't do this. But he's going to do something. You can bet that. He'll act. He'll do something. But you know, we earned our right to be here. And unless a person earns his right to be here and realizes that, he isn't going to appreciate this place, really. And if you stop and figure, sit down and figure out that the typical alcoholic that's been in business or in working, and he retains the age of 40 years, it has cost him a minimum of $50,000 to get here. Believe me, that is some entrance fee. A lot of people join a country club and it costs them $1,000, and $1,000 a year and so much to play every time they go out. They think they're big stuff. They don't pay any $50,000. But you and I paid $50,000 to get here. In money, lost opportunities, and to say nothing of the anguish and the heartache and other things that happened, the tragedies that happened. So we are very much blessed that we had this opportunity, and I'll tell you why. Alcoholism is probably the oldest malady that afflicts the human race. You read about alcoholism in ancient history. You read about it in the Bible. You read about it in mythology. There are a lot of good rummy stories in the Bible. This thing of boozing has gone on a long time. And if you once get reading the Bible, you'll find it's very interesting. You don't have to go any further than the first book of the Bible, and you'll meet your first rummy. You'll meet Noah, the guy that had the boat. There's a rummy. You don't believe it? I'll tell you. You listen to this one. If this guy isn't a rummy, I'm a Chinaman. The world has got itself in a shape about the way it is today. Everything going down, hell-bent for disaster, you know. And God couldn't get these people to get off this kick. He finally gave up and he decided to wipe the whole thing out. Going to flood the whole thing and start all over again. Well, he needed some seed to start with, so Noah was a good man, and he trusted God, and he loved him. So he went to Noah, and he says, Noah, my boy, he says, you should do something for me. He says, anything, Lord. He says, I want you to build a big boat. He gave him the directions and the dimensions of this boat. And he says, I want you to put, after you finish it, two of everything in there, every living creature, and I want you to put your family in there. He says, why? He says, well, I'm going to flood this whole world and destroy everything in it, and I want to start all over again. And you're going to be the seed. You're going to furnish the seed. Okay, that's all Noah had to know, is what God wanted to do. So he goes to work, got his family out there cutting logs and working for years and years on that bloody boat. And you can imagine what old Noah got from the neighbors. They come by and say, what are you doing, Noah? I'm building a boat. You're building a boat out here in the middle of a desert? You know, and Noah is playing with a short deck. Well, he kept on regardless of the criticism. He finally got the boat built. And sure enough, he got all his animals and everything else in it. I wonder why he put those two mosquitoes in there. Well, anyway, he put everything in there, and then finally the rains came, and it rained, and it rained, and it rained, and it rained for 40 days and 40 nights, and that boat starts to come up, and everything else is going down. A lot of those people who were laughing at Noah tried to get in that boat when they saw that rain coming. They finally believed what Noah said, but he wouldn't open the door. They just had to stay out there and take what is coming to them. So the whole world got flooded out. And for several months, that boat floated around on that water. And finally, after a few months, the water started to recede, and the boat came down and settled on Mount Ararat. And the land came up, and what was the first thing our friend Noah did? He ran out there and planted a vineyard, he raised some grapes, he made some wine, and got drunk. It's all in the Bible. I didn't make this up, it's in there. Now, I just mentioned that to point out that this alcoholism is nothing new. There's a lot of good rummy stories. I could stand here for an hour and tell you different rummy stories in the Bible, and they're all good. Some of them are, you probably never heard that they were rummy stories, but you can associate with them when you hear them told properly. These ministers don't know how to tell these stories. I hear some of these people talk about the Good Samaritan. They don't know he's a rummy. You ought to hear some of the stuff they hand out that that story means. And they talk about that prodigal son. They give you some of the wildest stories of why this guy was a prodigal son. They never occurs to these poor earthlings that these guys were rummies. They were. They're strictly drunk stories. Well, anyway, alcoholism for centuries has been with us, is the only point I want to make. And all down through these centuries, believe me, everything has been tried. I have a book at home, it's about this thick, and it was written way back in the early 1800s, about the history of alcoholism and what had been done up to that time in an order to solve this problem of heavy drinking and alcoholism. And you would be amazed at all the things that were tried, and don't you know something? Not a one of them worked. And this is history. So finally, about 40 years ago, this program came along. We grew out of the Oxford movement. We had a program presented to us that works. Up to this time, the alcoholic, all down through these centuries, had two options. He could go crazy or die or both. About 40 years ago, this fellowship got together the way it is now, and the alcoholic got a third option. He can still go crazy, he can die, or he can get well. That's the story. And you and I get well. We have the answer to it. Why people will not pay any attention to it? Because they're so stubborn and because they're so fearsome. They fear, fear, fear. Fear is what kills us. Fear is a motivating factor in the alcoholic's life. We are afraid to change our spots and change our whole direction. We're afraid to accept something that has a connotation of spirituality to it. We were in a meeting, a couple of the boys are here tonight. We were in a meeting not just a week or so ago, and these two boys got up and had the audacity in an AA meeting to mention Jesus Christ. And did they get torn apart? You don't talk about God and Jesus in this AA meeting. This is AA. Can you imagine that? And this is an old group. This is not a bunch of beginners that just come off the drugs or something. Really. These are supposed to be smart people. I wonder what they think, where this program came from. I wonder. I wonder if they ever read or ever study what these 12 steps say. It tells here how it works. Now, how does it work? Let me tell you how it works. Let me read this. Purposely, we didn't read this before the meeting, so I'm going to read it now. You hear this at all these meetings, and most every meeting we attend, we hear this read. Let me read it to you. So this is how it works. So don't everybody tell anybody you don't know why this works or how it works. Here is how it works. Rarely have we seen a person fail who has thoroughly followed our path. Thoroughly. Get that word. Those who do not recover are people who cannot or will not completely give themselves to this simple program. Did you get that completely? Right? Okay, usually men and women who are constitutionally incapable of being honest with themselves. I always hesitate to talk about honesty in connection with alcoholics, but it's in the book. There are such unfortunates. They are not at fault. They seem to have been born that way. They are naturally incapable of grasping and developing a manner of living which demands rigorous honesty. See? Their chances are less than average. There are those, too, who suffer from grave emotional and mental disorders, but many of them do recover if they have the capacity to be honest. This is how it works. Don't forget this. Our stories disclose in a general way what we used to be like, what happened, and what we are like now. Now listen to this one. Here's a qualification for membership in AA. Right here. Listen to this very carefully. Because if you're not ready to do this, you're not ready for this program. It says, if you have decided you want what we have and are willing to go to any lengths to get it, you are now ready to take certain steps. Roll that in over a while. If you want what we have and are willing to go to any lengths, see? It says, as some of these we balked. We thought we could find an easier, softer way, but we could not. With all the earnestness at our command, we beg of you to be fearless and thorough from the very start. Some of us have tried to hold on to our old ideas, and the result was nil until we let go absolutely. Absolutely. No hanging on to anything. Let the whole thing go down the drain. Remember that we deal with alcohol, cunning, baffling, powerful. Without help, it is too much for us. But there is one who has all power. That one is God, not the light bulb, that's God. Okay? May you find him now. Now listen to this one. Half measures avail us nothing. It doesn't say that half measures avail us half results. It says nothing. How about that? We are extremists, and we can't do anything halfway. When we drank, when we worked hard. We play hard. When we drink, we make a career out of it. So half measures, we don't know anything about. But people come into this fellowship through fear and one thing or another. They try to go through half measures, and they miss the boat. They don't get what they should be getting out of this fellowship, not by a long shot. Some of them stay dry. But they don't have any fun. We're here to enjoy life and here to serve. And unless we get ourselves straightened around, we're not going to get much out of that. Then it says, here are the steps we took which are suggested as a program of recovery. Alcoholics can screw up anything. They can screw up a two-car funeral. And they screw this up. This sentence here reads this way to me. Here are the steps we took which are suggested as a program of recovery. It doesn't say these are the suggested steps, but you can suggest them and you can take them or leave them. And they're suggested as a program of recovery. See what it means? People screw this up and get it turned around ass backwards. Well, here we go. Our program is divided into four phases. The first step is the first phase. That's a phase of admittance. Listen to that first step. It says two things in this first step, and most people only hear one. Most people hear one part of that step. They hear the first part. It says, we admitted we were powerless over alcohol. They don't hear this other part at all. And our lives had become unmanageable. See? There are 200 well-chosen words in these 12-step program. And alcohol is mentioned once. But there's an awful lot said in the rest of those steps about getting our life manageable. And that's what we have to do if we want to recover and have a good life and be happy with it and be serviceable. Yeah, any dingbat can quit drinking. You can quit drinking in jail. You can get sick, and you get somebody put a noose around your neck or something, you can't swallow it. But there's a lot of ways you can quit drinking, but that's not satisfactory. No. Booze is always going to be here in this world. There's no way that it's ever going to be eliminated because people will have it, and it's an accepted thing socially. And people, I was talking to some new people the other night, and they're talking about the alcoholic, how he changes, and the person who's a real alcoholic, he starts out drinking in social functions, and he's bragging about his drinking, brags about it. Boy, did I get a load on last night, you know. Oh, do I have a head today. He brags about his drinking, eh? Brother, then the time comes when he starts lying about it. And man, when he gets there, he's in trouble. When you start lying about it, hiding those jugs, and trying to, all this self-justification that goes with it, we're in trouble then. So, people hear that, we admitted we are powerless over alcohol, and you hear them yammering about alcohol, 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 alcohol. They keep drink conscious the rest of their life. What we want to do is get the drink consciousness out of us and get something else in our life. Eh? Okay? My life is unmanageable. If my life is unmanageable and I can't manage it, and I admit it, I better find myself a manager. That's as simple as I can see it. Very simple. So, it says the next step, we came to believe. I came to believe, it doesn't say I believed this when I got here, I came to believe that a power greater than myself could restore me to sanity. The sanity bit never bothered me too much. I find some of the brethren get a little bit touchy about it, but you start looking over your life and some of the things you pulled off, if those are the antics of a sane person, I'll take vanilla. But here I came to believe. Why did I come to believe that a power greater than myself could restore me to sanity? I'll tell you how I did it. The men who preceded me came to visit me in that hospital in Akron, in City Hospital. These alcoholics. They were all older men than I was. That's why I'm the last one left of the original bunch. I just outlived them, that's all. And they had been down that road in alcohol. And they'd been through the ringer, believe me. And they told me this power had helped them and would help me if I would but ask for it. And I wanted to believe them. That's how I came to believe them. I wanted to believe them. I wanted to get well. And I was willing to do anything that they told me. That's my willingness. This is what's necessary. All right. The second phase of our program is the second through the seventh step. We have the first phase is admission, second phase is submission, second through seven. Third step says, I made a decision to turn my will and my life over to the care of God. I hear people come in and say, you can take anything you want for God. You can take the group, you can take that piano, you can take that light bulb. Yeah, oh, you hear that light bulb deal. I bet you've all heard it, haven't you? Heard the light bulb? Let me read the 12 steps with the light bulb. No kidding. We admitted we were powerless over alcohol, our lives had become unmanageable, came to believe that a light bulb greater than myself could restore me to sanity. I made a decision to turn my will and my life over to the care of my light bulb. I made a searching and fearless moral inventory of myself, admitted to my light bulb, to myself, and to another human being. How do you like that? My higher power has a name, and his name is God, and his son is Jesus. So I make no bones about it. Now, I didn't believe all this when I got here. I don't expect the person stumbling in here, too. But you better believe it if you want to get well and have a good life. There's more to this fellowship than just staying dry. There's a lot of airheads that come around here that can stay dry without doing anything. I don't think a lot of them were ever alcoholics to start with. And most of them don't have sense enough to be an alcoholic. To be an alcoholic, you have to have something on the ball. And some, you know, every alcoholic's a drunk, but every drunk's not an alcoholic. As I say, there's a lot of drunks. I associated with a lot of them. I was on Skid Row. You can't tell me too much about the type of drunks. And I tell you the fact, a lot of those birds that I drank with were not alcoholics, but they could drink as much booze as I could, and that's a big order, I'll give you. But they weren't alcoholics. They could quit any time that they get a different hobby. I couldn't do it. I couldn't quit. I'm hooked. And I know that I've always probably will be. I let other people take the chances. I'm not going to take chances myself. I don't have any need for booze. I don't have any desire for it. I don't have any love for it. I don't have any fear about it. It just isn't in my life, period. That's simple. I don't make a big deal out of it. So it says here, I made a decision to turn my will and my life over to the care of God. That's quite a decision for a guy that's been running away from God and trying to hide from him for a long time and trying to deny him and trying to put some substitute in his place. That's quite a thing to do. And that takes desperation more than anything else. We have to feel pretty desperate before we'll do that. But if we feel that way, it gets right back to what that qualification was. If you want what we have and are willing to go to any lengths, you're now ready. See? It's very simple, yeah? Then it says in the fourth step, here's one that most people stumble all over the place on. And it's very simple, but they don't understand or they're not taught properly what it is. Fourth step says, I made a searching and fearless moral inventory of myself. You know, people come to our house from all over creation. They hear about this freak down in Castleberry, Florida, that has some way of taking people through the steps in 2 days. And they've been fooling around with these steps for 2 years, and they're not past one yet. And so they wonder what this freak's up to. So they call up, and we talk to them. And some of them wind up coming down to find out what's going on. Some of them are curious, some of them really mean business. But they come. So when they come, now the girls are more liable to this than the men. They think this fourth step means that they have to recite every lousy, stinking deal they've ever been into all their life. And these poor gals, they sit down for weeks on end and write all this crud all over a bunch of papers, and they come to me, and when they get to step four, they hand me this sheaf of papers, which I just take and I turn around and throw it in the wastebasket, rather don't even look at it. I'm not interested in all the cruddy things that they did and all this crap. That's not what the fourth step calls for. If there's restitution to be made for some of the crud that you did in your life, that has nothing to do with the fourth step. That comes later. But that fourth step here says that we made a searching and fearless moral inventory. What are my moral capacities? What have I got morally that are good? What's bad? What do I have to get rid of? What's ruining me in my moral setup? There are characteristics that are tearing me apart. I have 20 questions I ask this person about these moral situations. Things like self-pity, self-justification, lying and self-condemnation, impatience, dishonesty, hate, resentment, and so on and on and on. There's 20 of them. These are the things we're looking for, and these are the things that are eating us up. These are the things we have to get rid of. But, there's a trick here. It says that my life's unmanageable. I can't manage. I can't do it. I'm at a loss. I'm not able to do it. Well, in step three, I made a decision to turn my will and life over to my new manager. Well, what have I got that guy for? Let him take it. So the thing I have to do is ask him to take these things away from me. I've been taught that between God and myself, anything is possible. Myself, I can't do it, but with him, there's no limit. So I wind up with 10 or 12 of these stinking things in my character that I have to get rid of. So what do? It says I admit it to God and to myself and to another human being. What did I admit? All that crud? No. The exact nature of my wrongs. What a slob I was. What a liar I was. How resentful, how hateful, and all this kind of business. What a liar I was. How dishonest I was, and all this. How I gossiped, and all that crap. These are the things. So I have to admit to him and to another human being. Why another human being? Well, when you're dealing with my manager, he demands that I talk to somebody else, a human being. I express myself to a human being vocally. Thank you. And it also says in the good book, where two or three are gathered together in my name, there will I be also. Well, if I'm going to have my manager do something for me, I got to have somebody sitting there alongside of me to witness the whole deal. That's the reason for that. Very simple, isn't it? See how easy this program is? Believe me, if this program wasn't easy, I couldn't do it. No one could that comes here. Because of the time an alcoholic's ready for AA, he is incapable of taking it on a tough job. It has to be easy. It's just that simple. But people say, oh, it's so hard, and I'm having an awful time with step four, step two, step one. They've been fooling around with that since for 5 years, living miserable, when they can, 2 days or one day even, they could get over the whole thing and forget it, go out and live like a king. Yeah. So, it says, I admit to God, myself, and another human being the exact nature of my wrongs. All right. Then it says this. Knowing that I'm an extremist, it says, we're entirely ready. Not kind of ready or about to get ready. I'm entirely ready. What? For what? To have God remove all these defects of character. He's going to remove them. I can't do it. How simple, isn't it? Let George do it. I'm ready to have him remove them. All of them, not just part of them. I'm very frank to admit there are some defects of character I'd like to keep. They're fun. But that isn't what the program calls for. And those fun things are usually the things that destroy us. So if we want to get well, there's the way we do it. This is a prescription for living. So what does it say then? I humbly asked him to remove my shortcomings. Humbly. I listened to in a meeting one night of some, they were reading out of one of those books, 12 Steps, 12 Traditions or something, and somebody writing that book was trying to explain humbly, and they got so far off the track, I didn't know what they're talking about. They got it all mixed up with humility and humbleness and crawling in the dirt and everything else. That's not what we do. Humbly means you approach your maker in a humble, worshipful manner. That's what it means. You recognize who he is and what your position to him is. That's what that means entirely. People make some things out of these things. You wonder where they get this crap. But that's the imagination of a rummy. Our imaginations are something else. Rummies, they should all be short story writers. After the seventh step, we go into the third phase, and that's restitution. That's the eighth and ninth step. It says we made a list of all persons we had harmed, now get this one, and became willing to make amends to them all. That's kind of hard, because there's people that we have insulted, people we've dealt with in one thing or another, and we don't want to talk to those people. And we don't want to get messed around with them. We were away from them, we don't want to get near. Fear. But that ain't what the program calls for. We have to do it. It says we made a list of all persons we harmed and became willing. We have to have a willingness to make amends to everyone. Obviously, we cannot make amends to everyone we've harmed. That's impossible. Because some people have moved away, they're out of our orbit, they're dead or what have you, they're gone. The only thing we can do about that is I ask our manager to straighten it up for us, and he'll do it. Really, that's the only way to do it. That's what you got a manager for. He does the things you can't do. Why should you sweat it? Then it says, I made direct amends wherever possible, except when to do so would injure them or others. This is a thing, a person should never go around doing this amends business without the advice, counsel of a real wise sponsor. Because in our newness in this life, we get so excited about things, we start running off in four directions at once, and it's a very easy matter to get other people involved in some things that we have no business involving them in. So this is those steps should be taken with a good sponsor and follow his advice, a person that's living a good type of life in AA. Not just because some guy's been around here for 20 years. I know some guys in 20 years are still bums. The only difference is they're sober bums now. They were drunken bums, now they're sober bums. They're worse bums than they were when they're drunk, because they should know better. You know one? You're shaking your head. You know some of them, huh? Oh, good. I'm glad I'm not alone. You don't know any. Yeah. Let's not get into personalities. Now we've gone through three phases of our program. We've gone through nine steps. Now we get into the last phase. That's phase of construction. There's the last three steps, 10, 11, and 12. Listen to number 10. 10 has nothing to do with it's an inventory step, but it has nothing to do with step 4 at all, which also is an inventory step. Step 4 calls for a personal inventory. It says we made a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves in step 4. The other one calls a personal inventory in step 10. There's a vast difference. This moral inventory has all those moral degeneracies of ours that you list. But that isn't what the 10th step is about at all. The 10th step is a personal checkup on our actions every day, today. People talk about one day at a time. You know, most people, you ask them what they mean by that. No, I'm going to stay sober a day at a time. Oh, nuts. If you're in here only stay sober a day at a time, you're in the wrong league. Forget it. You're in here to live a day at a time. If you live a day at a time the way you ought to be living, you'll never worry about sobriety or drunkenness either. I can tell you that from experience. Nobody was any worse drunk than I was. And I have no problem with about booze and I haven't had, never have. Why? Because I did what these birds told me to do about this program. I don't say that people showered me with gifts or showered me with gold or anything. I had a lot of problems to solve like anyone else come in here. Telling somebody tonight, and when I came here, I had to change my whole economic setup. I was out of the line of work that I had been accustomed to and good in and experienced in. I couldn't go in it. They wouldn't let me in the first place. But if they would, I wouldn't want it anyway. I just couldn't take it anymore. So I changed from being that kind of a executive to a salesman. Complete change. I'm ordering people around, making everybody do my work, to going out and working myself. That's a change. But I became a good salesman. I mean it. I say so myself. I did all right, everything I ever sold. But you see, and Rummy can do these things, and what we get into after we straighten up might be something entirely different than what we used to do. Got people in lines of work coming into AA that ought to get out of them. They're not good for them. They're devil's handiwork. You should get out of the crap, that kind of stuff. If you can't, in good conscience, do what you're doing in your job, get out of it and get something else. That's good advice, believe me. You might not like to give up that buck that you get from. You might have to work for half the money. But what are we here for? We're here to learn how to live and live the way human beings ought to live and be serviceable. That's what we're here for. And we're going through life here. We have so much time here, how much, who knows? We're allotted so many hours, so many days, so many weeks, so many years. Then the day comes and we leave here. Where do we go? To me, there's only two places to go. A lot of people think there's three or four. There isn't. It's two. You leave here, kid, you're going to either go to hell or you're going to heaven. There ain't any excursions either way. You're going to make it one way or the other. And how you're going to make it is how you serve your new manager while you're here. That's my message. If I serve my manager properly, I know where I'm going. Yeah, you hear a lot of people, you go up to some people say, you're going to go to heaven when you die? Oh, I hope so. Hope so, hell, I'm going. I'm going, you bet, and I hope I see you there. I find out that I have done something, I have insulted somebody or done something I shouldn't do to them. Because we're human, we'll make mistakes. And I find out that I owe him an apology. I have to go do that right away. You can't afford to wait. That procrastination will never get it done. So the first thing is first. Make that restitution. See, our life gets straightened up in the first part of this program. Now we're trying to live it that way, so that we keep it clean. Anytime I take a person through the steps, I get down through the eighth, through the seventh step, I tell them they're clean. God has forgiven everything you've ever done. He owes nothing against you. See, the one thing great about my manager, when he forgives, he forgets. He'll never remind me of it anymore. Now, I'm human, and I can get fouled up again and louse up. But I'll know it when I do, and I know what to do about it. And I don't wait till next week to ask his forgiveness. I do it right now. Now, it gets to be a habit. And finally, you don't louse up so many times. You deal with as many people as I do, you get a lot of chances to screw up. Believe me, a lot of people are rather isolated. They don't have much trouble, a chance to get in trouble. But you get out and run around like some of we do. Brother, there's all kinds of things you have to deal with. And we can make mistakes like anybody else because there's nobody perfect. We're only reaching toward perfection. We never reach it here. We'll reach it someplace else on the other side, but not here. So we check on ourselves every day in step 10. Keep us clean. 11th step, listen to that one. It's got a lot of words in it. Says in the 11th step, I sought through prayer and meditation to improve my conscious contact with my new manager, God, praying only for knowledge of his will for me and the power to carry it out. Break that down. Listen to this. It says that we're seeking something. Seeking it through prayer and meditation. Now, what is prayer and what is meditation? What's the difference? Prayer to me is talking to my new manager. Meditation is listening to him. In all of my wisdom, I have found out that the good Lord gave me two ears and one mouth. And that suggests something to me. So it's a good idea to do some listening. And you may be amazed what you hear. If you would listen, there's something in that says that there's none so blind as those who will not see, and there's none so deaf as those who will not hear. And a lot of people will not hear, and they will not see. It's too bad. You don't have to be that way. There's nothing to be afraid of in this program. This is a program of courage. You have the greatest asset in the world when you go and join this program and go through these steps. You got a manager to take you through anything. Anything. People say to me, I've heard all these stock alibis for getting drunk. All of them. I've heard them say, oh, I lost my job, and I just got so frustrated, and I just went out and got drunk. Hell, I got fired how many times, I can't tell you. I've lost jobs. Then they say, well, I got divorced.
Well, so did I.
Well, I went into service, and you know how it is when you go into service. Yeah, I know how it is, but I didn't get drunk in the service. See? Well, I was supposed to get a promotion. It didn't happen. Well, my wife ran off with some other guy. Good riddance. Well, I mean, you get all this stuff all the time, and it's all baby talk. Baby talk. We come in here to learn how to grow up. And boy, do we have you and I have more characteristics and more power when we accept the power of God in our life. With the things that we can do, you wouldn't believe. I look back on my own life. I'm not waving any flags. But I look back on my own life and think of that skinny guy, 135 pounds, back in 1938-39, back there in Cleveland all by himself, no book, no friends, no money, no nothing, no nothing behind me, out there trying to get rummy straightened up. And the things that I did over there, I can't believe it myself when I think about it. I look back and it couldn't be me, but it was. Now, I wasn't doing that. I was propelled. I was guided to do these things. I've always said this, if I were to pick a guy to do the job I did in the early days of AA, I'd be the last guy I'd pick because I had no qualifications, or nothing, no qualification whatever for it. See? It's true. If you don't believe that, read that book, that Dr. Bob and the Good Old Timers. You'll find something about in that book. It'll tell you some of those stories. It's impossible. Some of the things that happened to some of those people couldn't have happened, but they did. And we had this wonderful fellowship. People walk into this fellowship today, they think it's always been like this. Oh, don't kid yourself. Some of the people around 25, 30, 35 years ago will tell you something about this fellowship, what it was like then. I'll tell you about it 44 years ago. No, there's a lot of things been changed. But the principles haven't changed. There's a lot of people trying to change them, and they do. They screw up this program. A lot of people do, if you listen to them. You read a lot of tripe that isn't worth reading, too. But here we are. Thought through prayer and meditation, talking to my manager and listening to him to improve my conscious contact with him. What does that mean? I have to feel and believe and sell myself the idea all the time that he's right here as close to me as Bill Daly here. And I can talk to him, I can get answers from him. He's there and I know he's there. See? Now that isn't talking to spooks either. He's here, he's everywhere. You don't believe this? Remember when the men landed on the moon, first guys to land on the moon, what'd they do? They prayed. They were talking to him up there on the moon, all those thousands and thousands and thousands of miles away. And you're talking to him down here. Boy, he's accessible, I'd say. He's right around, kid. Anytime you want him, he's here. He don't run away, we run away. Right? All right. So we thought through talking to him and listening to him to improve our conscious contact. Now it tells us what we're praying for. You ask a good many people in AA what they pray for every day. They say, oh, I prayed to stay sober today. Yeah, idiot. If you're in this program, you never pray to stay sober. You got sobriety. Thank him for it. Pray that he shows you what to do with your life to help somebody else. Hey, this is what we pray for. What is your will, boss? Tell me what you want and send me and give me the strength to do it. Tells me in a good book, he'll never put anything on me. He won't give me the strength to follow through with. So anything that I have to do, if I ask him, he'll send me. Some of the funniest things, the oddest things that have happened to me in my life. I've gone, just do talk about guidance and being set out to do something. I've made an appointment to meet somebody. 11:30, I'm going to meet you out at 9th and you'll... today. 9th and 11:30, I'm at 199th and un-Euclid someplace. And I had no plan to be there at all. I'd planned my day to be where I said I was going to be. But he had other plans for me. When I look back on some of those occasions, it really startles me. It does. Because in every instance, there was an awfully good reason why I was out at 199th instead of 9th. Something had to take place out there, and it was important that I were there. This sounds a little bit, probably to a lot of people, a little bit dizzy, but dippy. I got into a lot of dippy stuff in the years I've been in AA, and I see an awful lot of dippier stuff right now. All right, I sought through prayer and meditation to improve my conscious contact with God, praying only for knowledge of his will for me and the power to carry that out. What do you want me to do, boss? And give me the power to do it. 12-step, what does this say? People are always talking about 12-stepping. Holy smokes. What does it mean when it says 12-stepping? When you hear people talk about 12-stepping, it denotes running after some drunk or sitting up with him or feeding him booze or buying him a suit or something, I don't know, or you're going out seeing them and carrying them to a meeting and hauling them around and what have you. 12th step says, having had a spiritual experience, get this, here's some words they missed entirely, as the result of these steps. Because we took these steps, the result was we had a spiritual experience. And what is that?
spiritual experience. People say, oh, change, get your mind changed. Change your mind. Change your mind. What mind? Change your thinking, they say. What thinking? If an alcoholic is thinking, he gets in trouble. We don't think, as I said before, we emote. So, it says, having had a spiritual experience as the result of taking these steps, we had that spiritual experience is not here. It's 18 inches below. It's down here. This is where the change comes, down in here, not here. That noodle, the head's always sick. It tells you that in the Bible. You read that in Isaiah. The whole head is sick, it says. Well, if anybody ever had a sick head, we've had them, boy. No, it's... You know, everything in this program came from the Bible. Believe that. It came from the Sermon on the Mount and the Book of James, but there's some references to the Old Testament, too. You get into old Isaiah and some of these deals, too. But it says here, we tried to carry this message. Not the alcoholic. You don't haul those birds around on your back and nurse them and kiss them and all this kind of crap. You're there to carry a message to them if you have a message to carry. If you don't have a message, take somebody with you that does. Then you'll learn how. That's as simple as I can tell it. So, we tried to carry this message to alcoholics. Did you get that? It didn't say we're carrying them to everybody, the whole world. We, our ministry is alcoholics, and we are the only dingbats that can help alcoholics. Nobody else can do it. That's been proven down through the centuries. So that gives us a responsibility. And we're not supposed to, as the Bible says, cast our pearls before swine. We're supposed to go and plant seeds where they can be expected to grow. And you can't grow them carrying these monkeys around on your back. You come and you present your program to them the best way you can and try to enthuse them about it, and they get it. From that point on, the Holy Spirit takes on. He's going to do the rest of it. We can't fix anybody. We call it fixing, but we just introduce them to it. From that point on, we have to leave it up to the manager. And he'll fix them if they mean business. If they don't, they'll go right down the sewer as usual. And it says we're going to practice these principles in all of our affairs. What principles? Principles of love and service. I just wish people would just sit down and work and work and read and read and study and discuss those 12 steps. They start discussing them, and then they start talking about a lot of crap that has nothing to do with this program. They get all fouled up on a lot of traditions and a lot of anonymity and all that bull. Don't mean anything. I'm not ashamed of people knowing I belong to this fellowship. I'm rather proud of it. I paid a heck of a price to get here. And I know some things a lot of those people don't know. And I feel some things they'll never feel. I've been blessed with a lot of things I wish they could be blessed with, but they're never going to have it. You know, we're the most fortunate people in the world. God does not pick out the cream of the crop. He picks out some real buzzards to serve him. If you don't believe that, kids, read the life of the apostles. Read about those disciples. What a rough bunch they were. There were only two of them the whole bunch could write. Yeah, there was two of them that had any education at all. One was a tax collector and the other was a doctor. The rest of them were a bunch of roughnecks. And boy, he used to get teed off on them once in a while, too. Naturally, he would. But these are the kind of people he picks. He picks them when they're really kicked around and they're ready for something. Because a person that's never been hurt and has had everything, you have a hard time selling the idea of making his life become manageable. What is he going to manage? He's got everything. Read the story of the rich young ruler. That tells you very well in the Bible. He comes to Jesus. He says, what must I do to be saved? He had everything, this guy had. He says, give all you have to the poor and follow me. Boy, the guy couldn't do it. That's the last you ever heard of him. Hey? It's true. Well, we got a guy sitting in this room tonight. He's got a business. he finally found out when he met this manager of his that this business don't belong to him. Don't belong to him. And he's only the steward of this business. And so he's letting his manager run the business because he screwed it up so bad. And since he's letting the manager run the business, his money's coming into him, he can't count it. He's sitting right in this room here. I'm not going to make him stand up, but I bet you some of you know him. He doesn't think he's so smart. He's got a good business. Anybody look at that guy and say, boy, that guy's got a good, really got a good, he's got a, he must be a sharp guy. He's a slob. But God takes care of him because he's his man. He's turned everything over and he depends on God to run it for him. And he does his part as little as possible. But it works. And he'll probably tell you about that himself before the weekend's over. Believe me. Well, that's the program. That's how it works. So if somebody asks you, how does this work? Just tell them what I said tonight. And you got it made. How long have we been at this? I've only been talking an hour and a half. Well, let's get into part two. Now, this is a wonderful situation. I'm sure glad that I have had the opportunity and have been blessed with the opportunity to be among people such as you for so many years. I've been around here many more years than what a lot of people have been on earth here that's sitting in this room. Yeah, that's true. And I'm very thankful for that. And whatever happens to me, if I'm not here in the morning, I'm someplace better. I'll miss you, but I'll see you all again, I'm sure. But it's been a wonderful life to me. I am past 79 years old. And, you know, usually a person's allowed 70 years, 70. I beat that so far. And I've seen a lot of my old friends pass on to their rewards. And every year those ranks get thinner and thinner and thinner. But I know where most of those people wind up. And they wouldn't have had a Chinaman's chance had they not got into this fellowship. But I've seen a number of those people pass away, and pass away happy and contented and with no fear or whatever. In fact, they're welcome. They welcome what come. I know one fellow, and some of you people have met this bird. I remember one time he actually died on a hospital table, and he was dead for some time. And a bunch of them prayed him back into this world again. And he says, don't ever do that again if I go again. Things were too good where he went. They brought him back. He got mad at the people. Well, that's old Hal Hill. If you, some of you guys know him. You read a lot of his books. Yeah, this is true. And there's other experiences happen like that. But there's a wonderful life here. It prepares us for what's coming. And you and I have a chance to serve unlike any other person has in this community. We have alcoholics here to work with and people who want to get their lives straightened out. Every alcoholic has to get his life straightened out. A lot of them don't have to go to the extent in their drinking that I did or some of the other people did. No, we're getting a lot of youngsters in here now. But they know that their life is wrong, and they want to do something with it. It's up to us to know what this program is and know how to give it to them, and know how to help inspire them to accept it and apply it. And you and I have this privilege. Now, what else? What other society do you find where you can find this kind of a ministry, where you are an expert? You are an expert. You are an authority. You're an authority in alcoholism. I belong to a number of different fellowships and lodges and clubs and organizations. I'm a joiner. And I have always taken some active part in everything I ever joined. And I've enjoyed a lot of these outfits and these different lodges and different things that I belong to, and I still do. And I attend because it keeps me balanced well, because I need some balance need some other contact besides just the one thing all the time, naturally. You can't live on vanilla ice cream all the time. You have to have some nuts with it or something. But anyway, I have belonged to these outfits and have been active in them. But I enjoyed them, and I've gotten some benefits from them. And I like to feel I've contributed something also. But I have never, there's no outfit that I know of that can match what we have here in this fellowship. Because this is a life-giving and a life-sustaining fellowship. We take people who are dead and make them, help them to live. And what a life we have. What a life. It's been awful nice talking to you. And I know I'll be talking to a lot of you personally before the weekend's over. And I'm happy that you all came here. And we were fortunate in getting enough beds for all the people we have this time. Next time we'll have more beds, so bring a friend next time and we'll give them the benefit of something that's real. This is real AA that you're going to get here. It's not a lot of this hogwash that you hear, and they talk about a lot of things that have nothing to do with changing your life at all. So we all know what I'm talking about. Come here, you'll learn something about living, and that's what we're here for. Learn how to live as human beings are supposed to. Thank you very much.